I'm certainly privileged, and we as a congregation are privileged to have Pastor Haman and his wife with us for this entire week. We've been blessed, encouraged, amen. Both, they have the ability to span two generations of friendship, both with my parents and with my wife and I. And it's been for many, many years that we have enjoyed and interacted in relationship, friendship with them. And I count it a privilege to have them on probably what is a very, very short list of friends that I can reach out to and find encouragement and just plain fun for that matter. You know, it's okay. God has fun. It's okay for us to have fun. Amen? Amen. And Pastor Haman has been that for me. Pastors a great church, a revival church in Denver, Colorado. Him and his wife are leading that church into multiple venues of revival as they spread out over the Denver, greater Denver area. I've been privileged to preach there. Our senior pastor has been privileged to preach there. We have a great relationship and God's doing great things. And it's really awesome to see that God is doing great things everywhere. Amen? It's great to know that God is doing great things everywhere. Amen. And so this morning, I ask that you would open up your ears, your hearts, and your minds, and allow the Word of God to be planted inside of us, that it might grow and that it might produce fruit, and that that fruit might remain. Let's lift our hands and ask God for that this morning in our life. We love you, Lord Jesus. We thank you for your Spirit that is present here. We ask, Lord God, that you would help us, encourage us, lift us. Lord, as we have worshiped you, our hearts are set, our minds are open. We're ready to hear the word of the Lord. If we don't have the Holy Ghost, God, today we want to receive the Holy Ghost. If we haven't had our sins washed away through baptism in your name, today is a good day for that to happen. If we need connection in our homes, if we need connection in our relationships, today is a good day for that to happen through your word. We ask in your precious holy name. One more time, give the Lord a hand praise as Pastor Haman comes to the pulpit.
Thank you, brother. Hallelujah. Now, I recognize the time, and I'm going to be done as quickly as possible. And I would not like to remain in a position that is interposing itself between you and lunch or whatever else you have to engage in today. But I wonder if we could just agree together that we want the Lord to really do what he wants to do here today. As a pastor for 30 years, involved in the ministry all my life, I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, I have been in your position many, 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 many times. And what we have to do is agree that the preacher wants God as much as the listener wants God. The preacher wants God's timing as much as anyone else here wants God's timing. And I am not one minute going to stand in the way of God. And I want the Lord to have his perfect will and perfect way. Amen. I appreciate somebody already crying out back there for the Holy Ghost. Except you become as little children. Amen. I did hear somebody over there, right? All right. Psalm 37, verse 4. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Read it one more time. It's a short verse, and I'd like everybody to engage vocally, verbally, lift your voice. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Do you believe that? Do you really believe that? Not everybody's acting as convinced as I thought we should. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. That means if my heart wants a yacht, praise God, he's going to give it to me if I delight myself in him, right? Few people are buying in. That means if I delight myself in the Lord, he'll give me the biggest mansion on a hillside. If I delight myself in the Lord, he'll give me the car I want to drive. If I delight myself in the Lord, he'll let me shop at Abercrombie and Fitch and wherever else I want to shop, right? He'll let me shop at the finest stores. He'll give me the finest income. He'll give me the greatest 401k program. Does that kind of sound a little fishy to somebody? Anybody sound like I'm really kind of tongue-in-cheek right there? That is not what he's talking about. He's not talking about getting whatever you want. He's talking about getting another desire. He's talking about a transplant of the desires of your heart. Now, some of us are like, hold on just a minute. I don't know how badly I want what God wants for me. What does God want for you? What are God's desires? Well, I wonder if it's possible for God's desires to become mine. And if that's ever going to happen, I've got to be willing to let him open me up with open heart surgery. I got to lay down on an operating table and say, go ahead and open up that chest cavity, Jesus. Lord, you see the old heart beating in there, and it's got some stuff it wants that is not good for me. Oh, I wish a few of you would go ahead and preach with me right now. That heart is only going to give me destruction and disappointment and misery. So, Lord, go ahead and take that old heart out of there that has my desires. And, Lord, I want you to put your desires right there where my heart used to be, so that when I'm sewn up and I'm healed up and I get up off of this operating table, I'm going to walk around with a brand new heart of desire. Everybody say amen. Amen. Even everybody that's not so excited about it, say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right. I think everybody's excited. Yeah. Hallelujah. You know, I would tell you to run the aisles, but I'd be afraid we'd need to get a paramedics team out here with all the long distance we got around here. God bless you. You can be seated in Jesus' name. I am breathtaking. I am blown away, and my breath is taken away at this facility, this expansive facility that is here representing the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. I want to thank God for the vision he's given Senior Pastor Libby, and the vision subsequently that the Lord has given to Pastor Sean Libby to see the church proceed and go forward in Jesus' name. And as a friend of theirs, I, by God's grace, pray to be able to be engaged in some way to be a helpful friend and minister in the work of the Lord and partner with them. Amen. Praise God. It's 9:30 in Denver, and I'm praying for our home service today in Jesus' name. And that's your partner church. I don't know if you knew that, but because the pastors are so close, we might as well go ahead and let the congregations be close. Y'all ought to pray for CAC once in a while. We'll pray for CLC. Amen, amen. Brother Sean Libby, I'm telling you, that guy has been the best of friends. He has come in as my rescue hero so many times and been such a selfless giver of himself. He has, I had an entire Mile High conference, our national conference a few years ago, and suddenly I choked up and my voice wouldn't work anymore. I could not talk. And guess what? Brother Sean Libby knows my heart, knows my desire, knows my focus well enough that he was able to step up in virtually every capacity that I held and make it continue without even a hitch. Thank God. I'll never forget that kindness, Brother Sean Libby. He's a great man. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You see the picture on the big screen? It has the same scripture that we just read. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Pretty perfect picture graphic to help us to see that our heart needs a transplant of desires. Amen. I'll tell you, I'm going to be honest with you. When I grew up, I always thought of that scripture as being my magic Santa Claus type, Christmas type, birthday gift kind of wonderful Jesus, God is so good scripture. There was a lot of hyphens in that, wasn't there? Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will be Santa Claus. If you delight yourself in the Lord, he will be the great pie in the sky, just pouring it out. He'll open the windows of heaven, and you'll get whatever you want. And sometimes I remember feeling like, man, what is wrong with that scripture? Because I'm not getting my stuff. I think I'm doing my part. How come I'm not getting what I know? Come on now. But the Lord caught me on my knees one time, and can I tell you something? That's a good place for the Lord to catch up with you. If you haven't been on your knees in a little while, I invite you to get on your knees today sometime before this next this service is over in the next few minutes and see if the Lord might catch up with you and help you to understand something brand new about this verse. It is so urgent that our desires be placed in a position of surrender and subordination and say, God, not my will, but thy will be done. I don't necessarily, I want stuff and I need stuff and I wish this would happen. Now, we are literally in a journey, and Wednesday night's message, not really perfectly related to this message today, except for this one fact, that as we journey between Egypt or the past, whatever that is for you, and as we work our way toward and journey our way toward heaven, and our ultimate reward with Jesus Christ in eternity, there's a pretty amazing and pretty overwhelming in-between time that we've got to become aware of and come to grips with, that God does not give us instantaneous satisfaction and instantaneous gratification. You know what? God knows that instant gratification is destructive. Somebody say amen. God knows that instant gratification will kill you, it'll distract, it'll pull you, it'll make you someone who is not even what he wants you to be, and you'll become useless and worthless in his kingdom. So he has a way of saying, grow up on the way. You got to become a little more familiar with the process. Become aware of the fact that this is not going to be a day, one day you're in the wilderness, the next day you're in the promised land. There's going to be some time you've got to learn to grow, time you've got to learn to get away from the things of the past, the time you've got to get to a place of maturity so that you can become worth something in the ultimate eternal kingdom of God. I want to be worth something to Almighty God. I want to be, as I preached Wednesday night, I want to come forth as gold. In Jesus' name. That's fun to talk about the gold part, but what about the heat part? What about the fire? What about the furnace? So on this journey, one of the ultimate ways the enemy will stop our journey, procession, and our progress is by getting us tripped up with our own evil desires. So I want us today to come face to face with the evil desires that have a way of calling us out and pulling us off the path, pushing us away from God's will. And if we're not careful, our heart can be the part of us that is the most powerful. Actually, it is the most powerful part of you. Can I just break in and say that Solomon, remember King Solomon, the wisest man to ever live? I want you to remember that King Solomon had all the wisdom that anybody's ever had in the world before or after. So God gave him a mind gift. But you know what? God didn't change his heart. He only changed his mind. God gave him wisdom in the head, and that was not enough to overcome the pleasures, the desires, the affections of his heart. Somebody say amen. Amen. You know what the Bible says? That as soon as his wives and his lifestyle pulled his heart away from God, it made God angry, and he ended up as a man that was pulled off of God's plan, even though he had all the wisdom of the world. Be careful the gifts God gives. Let's not let God give gifts to us without letting him also change our heart, without doing internal operations. Come on, somebody, I believe that if Solomon would have had a chance to bow his knees at an altar and say, God, I give my heart to you. I don't want my affection to be set on anything below. I want to set my affection on things that are above. Then Almighty God would have, I believe, helped him in his heart. So today, let's consider the ultimate devastation of a heart that is out of control. A desire-driven individual is an individual that needs to be channeled and focused in the right direction. Now let's really quickly look at the scripture. I'm just going to jump down to the end of, for the sake of time, the end of the story. And a few of you may remember this. New Living Translation. This is real quick. I'm going to read to you. I could read an entire story, but it's 1 Kings 21, verse number 11. Excuse me, verse number 17 says, but the Lord said to Elijah. Anybody remember Elijah? What was the stuff Elijah did? Does anybody remember Elijah? What did Elijah do? Elijah's a prophet. Remember the mighty miracles he did? Remember he, when the famine was going on, he helped for there to be provisions. He helped for there to be food. He was one who was literally used of God to be a benefit and a positive influence all over him and everywhere he went. Now, the scripture says, the Lord said to Elijah, go down to meet King Ahab of Israel who rules in Samaria. He will be at Naboth's vineyard in Jezreel, claiming it for himself. So hold on just a minute. Whose is this? It's Naboth's, God says. God never says that it is Ahab's. He says this is Naboth's vineyard. And when God speaks, we need to pay attention. God said that is Naboth's vineyard in Jezreel. And while the king's there, here's what he's doing. He's claiming it for himself. Give him this message. This is what the Lord says. Wasn't it enough that you killed Naboth? Must you rob him too? Because you've done this, dogs will lick your blood at the very place where they licked the blood of Naboth. That's a fairly gruesome depiction of the way a man's going to die and a confrontation of a man with his sin by his maker. God asked Elijah to confront Ahab. That's kind of a scary thing for preachers to have to do God's bidding when we never know what the reaction's going to be of human nature. But you know what? When we have the power of God behind us and we know exactly what God has said and we are convinced of God, and we can move, we can make a difference, we don't have to worry, we don't have to be ashamed, but we can speak up. And that goes for everybody here who's given the gospel mandate to take to our world outside these four walls. You may not know what they're going to say, you never know what the human nature response is going to be, but by God's grace, we're going to keep on preaching, keep on teaching, keep on having life groups, keep on having Bible studies and doing God's work. Amen? Praise God. You know, speaking of the evil in our world today, Brother Libby, thank you for leading in that prayer. It's a horrific situation, a horrific scenario in Paris this weekend that could never have been dreamed up. Just absolutely gruesome and so tragic. The sadness of 130 individuals, casualties it seems, and so many more hundreds are hurting and mortally wounded it would seem today. It is a very, very sad thing. But you know what? When Brother Libby was talking about Sunday night church, he made me think about this. Sunday night invitation to come to church on Sunday night. He made me think about this verse. The verse is found in Ezekiel 3 and verse number 8. God told Ezekiel, behold, I have made thy face strong against their faces and thy forehead strong against their foreheads. In other words, don't be wimpy against a strong enemy. I'm going to make you stronger than them. You've got to have a greater power behind you. If you're going to be successful in your work, Ezekiel, then you're going to have a stronger forehead. When you butt heads with them, their head's got to break before yours breaks. That's what he's talking about. You know what? I'm going to tell somebody here tonight that it's easy to live for God, real easy. And then when the hard time comes, you disappear. I say it's time to live for God hard. I say it's time to live for God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and not let any little things distract us from coming to church. When the doors open, we ought to be in the house of God. There is no telling what God has waiting for somebody in tonight's service. If you just make up your mind, I'm going to be there. And I want to have the forehead that is stronger than the forehead of the enemy. You know what we need to pray? We need to pray that the armed forces of the United States and the allies get really strong and get really bold and say ISIS must come down. The regimes of this world that would seek to destroy freedom need to come down. They need to have a strength about them that they have never experienced before. And you know what? If we hope that happens, why don't we be the first? Why don't we go ahead and say, you know what, evil? Your kingdom's coming down. Devil, your kingdom's coming down. I'm stronger than the enemy. And I want to tell you, the enemy has this one common theme. You know what the common theme of the enemy of our world is? I have got nothing to lose. Too many of us have something to lose, so we hold back. We rein in. We get reservations. We make plans, and we try to guard what we have, and guard our time, and guard our treasure, guard our talent. You know what I think it's time to do? I think it's time to be either all in or not in at all. I think it's time to say, I'm going all the way for the Lord because I have nothing to lose. I don't care what happens to me. I'm going to be on God's side, and I'm going to fight the good fight of faith no matter what happens to me. Nothing can stand against me. I am going to be stronger than the enemy. Come on, somebody. We've got an enemy we've got to fight. We've got an enemy we must prevail over. In Jesus' name. I'm going to run through the sad story of Ahab and Naboth, and I just get a show of hands in the sanctuary. Honestly, would you please raise your hands if you've ever heard the story of Ahab and Naboth's vineyard? Raise your hand. Good majority of you, you remember the fact that Ahab was acting like a baby. He looked at that vineyard. It belonged to Naboth, who was a man who had been given it by inheritance. It was God's allotment. It was God's place. It was God's gift. And Ahab wanted God's gift, and he wanted to take it away from Naboth. And Naboth said, I don't care what you offer me. I am not for sale. I don't care what you give me in exchange. I cannot get rid of my vineyard. I don't care if you want to give me the rest of the kingdom. I don't care if you want to give me the moon. I don't care if you want to give me the universe. You can promise anything to me, but my little vineyard is not for sale. He took a stand, like I'd like to see some apostolic Pentecostals in 2016. I know it's not here yet, but we're already thinking about it, aren't we? I'd like to see some Pentecostal apostolics in this day and age take a stand and say, devil, you can offer me everything you want to offer me, but I've got a desire that is committed to God. I've got a desire that is what I call a higher desire. That's today's message title. I want you to take it home with you. Higher desire. Everybody say higher desire. I admire Naboth for not wanting to take the opportunity to become a celebrity. He didn't want to take the opportunity to become someone recognized and noticed and someone who was just a nice guy willing to give over what he had to the king because the king would offer him kingdom privileges and kingdom blessings and good things that the king thought were more important. But Naboth said, the Lord forbid that I should give you the inheritance that was passed down by my ancestors. I thank God for the forefathers of the Pentecostal movement. I thank God for my father. I thank God for his parents. I thank God for my wife and for her parents. Brothers and sisters, we have received a very beautiful gospel inheritance. It's been passed down, and we have a responsibility not only to pass it down to our generation that's coming after us, but we need to pass it out as well. The Lord forbid that I give you the inheritance that was passed down by my ancestors. So Ahab went home angry and sullen because of Naboth's answer. This is verse 4. King went to bed with his face to the wall and refused to eat. That just blows me away. Look at 1 Kings 21, verse number 4. He went to bed with his face to the wall and refused to eat. How many mothers of toddlers, ever in your life you've been a mother of a toddler? Would you raise your hand? Does this sound just like stuff you deal with? But he's called a king. The king went to bed and he turned his face to the wall and he said, I don't want anything to eat. All I want's that vineyard. All I want is that little garden plot next door to the palace. Well, to make a long story short, his wife consoled him. And she said, Naboth's a nobody. We can just take care of him with flotting a swy. Have you ever flotted a swy before? Like swatting a fly. Like just stepping on a bug. No problem. He's just a little pesky pest in the way. We'll take care of him. And they indeed did. And you know what they ended up doing? They ended up making him falsely framed, carried him outside the city walls, and they stoned him to death. And the news was brought back to the queen. Naboth is dead. And the queen walks into Ahab and says, "Hey, Ahab, let's put our party hats on. It's time to have a party. The good news is you get the vineyard. It's yours." So Ahab immediately went down to the vineyard to claim it. And it was at that moment that the Lord spoke the words we just read. The Lord told Elijah, "Go confront Ahab because he's claiming the vineyard." So I have three out of control symbols, or three out of control sentences, or three out of control scenarios I would like to just share with you that show us the potential of a heart that is wanting something so badly it's willing to kill for it. Number one, an obsession Ahab never controlled. Number two, a transgression Ahab never intended. And then the man of God walks into the room. He walks into the garden. He walks into that vineyard. And you know what he says? He says nothing, because he didn't have a chance to say anything. The first one to speak is Ahab, sitting in his little vineyard. He thinks he's got it all figured out. He thinks he's just the happiest man on the planet. He's the king, and now he's proven to Naboth and everybody else that he can get what he wants. I can have it if I want it. It's mine. As he barely sits down and takes his seat, just at the moment he gets comfortable, sitting in the vineyard he claims for his own, he hears the footsteps of the man of God walking up the path. And in verse 20, he speaks first. Ahab says, "So, my enemy, you have found me. Oh, mine enemy, hast thou found me?" And the Lord said through Elijah, "I will bring disaster on you and consume you. I will destroy every one of your male descendants, slave and free alike, anywhere in Israel." And the whole sin was not the vineyard. It was a heart that was obsessed beyond control. Wow. Now see, it might seem like just a huge exaggeration, because some of us are like, "Man, I'll never do that. I'll never kill anybody because I want their garden." Well, I hope not. But you know what? There are things like that we may never do, but if we have a heart like that, that's even the slightest bit like that, and it's got the cancer of desire, out of control desire in it, we've got to say, "Lord, do some chemo on me today in this altar. Lord, do some extraction. Lord Jesus, do some extrication. Lord, help there to be a removal of that evil, that malignancy in me," because a heart is wicked above all things, the scripture says. It is wicked, and it cannot be controlled by ourselves humanly. We've got to have control above ourselves. In other words, we need a higher desire, and pray for God to transform our desire. I'm going to tell you one more time, and I can make this a long, long message, but I'm just going to tell you, the obsession that Ahab never controlled was something that he could have stopped in his tracks. The moment he looked at that vineyard and said, "I think I want it," he could have said, "No, that vineyard's not mine," but he did not stop at the obsession. It was an obsession he never controlled. And he moved into the transgression phase, and it was a transgression that Ahab never intended. I don't believe when Ahab first looked at that vineyard, he was planning on killing the owner, but it was a transgression that happened nonetheless. See the hidden deception behind the heart that is out of control, the heart that is not surrendered to God. It was a transgression that Ahab never intended, and then it ended up being a possession Ahab never enjoyed. "Hast thou found me, O mine enemy?" Listen, your heart, my heart, we have human hearts, and I'm talking about the seat of your affection right now. I'm talking about the part of you that makes decisions, the part of you that drives you, that wakes you up, that pushes you out of bed, that gives you the impetus to do what you do in your life, the things we want to do, the things we want to accomplish. We want to be workers in the kingdom of God. We want to do those things that are pleasing to the Lord. But you know, those things sometimes take second and third and fourth precedent, and we want to do other things first. We want to get around to things like whatever Brother Libby mentioned today, you know, the things that keep us out of church, things that keep us focused. You know, we got other things to do. We got other responsibilities. Well, what does it look like when we have an individual who has taken his desire and he's laid it on the table and said, God, rip it out of my chest and give me a brand new desire that looks like you? Well, let me just show you. I'm just going to show you really quickly here. This is exactly what it looks like. I believe the bottom line is this. Let's get down to the point where we can start seeing a new person, another character in the Bible that will be a perfect one to overshadow Ahab and help us to see the glorious power of a heart that's truly surrendered. Does anybody know the name of the man who was called the meekest man of all the earth? Moses. Moses. His meekness shined brightly and became the hallmark of his power. Now I'm going to tell you what meekness is. Meekness, just go home with this little definition. Meekness is strength under control. Strength under control. We probably have some big strong men in the sanctuary right now. You know, I believe we have some strong men in here that's so strong they could probably pick up another big man in this room. And it would be fun to just watch them do it, wouldn't it? But you know what? That same strong big man who can pick up another man can grab a hold of a precious little baby and hold that baby just the same in his strong arms, showing meekness, strength under control. He can rock that little baby. He could feed that little baby. He could burp that little baby. He probably wouldn't want to change the baby's diapers. But that's just sort of us guys, I guess. We do it. We do it. Trust me. You don't want to do it. Strength under control. Let me wrap this up with this section of scriptures. If you will, turn with me to Hebrews 11, 24. The Bible says, by faith, Moses, when he was come to years. Wow. Does anybody remember that point in your life? Now, some of us are still under that. Some of us are still a little too young to really comprehend what we're talking about with coming to years. But look at it on the screen. When Moses was come to years, you know what that means? That means when he probably was about the time he got a full beard. Truly. Truly. That's a euphemism in the ancient Jewish style of writing and telling stories. The scripture says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Old does not mean like wrinkles and gray or bald or holding on to a cane and can hardly walk anymore. When he is old means when he gets his beard. The Bible says when Moses was just outside of adolescence, when he was come to a position to start doing what he wanted to do. Come on now, somebody hear me. When Moses reached a day and an age in his life when he realized, hey, my mama not making me do this. My daddy's not making me do this. Ain't nobody making me do this. I can do whatever I want. Get out of my way. I know more than everybody in the world. Oh my goodness, I never heard of people like that before, have you? We need to just have a prayer meeting for all children who are in men's and women's bodies. And they're still under 25. Because they shouldn't be children past about 18. But some of them decide, you know what, some people decide to stay children all their lives. I guess it's just a choice. But the Bible says when Moses reached a point in his life when he literally was old enough to make his own mind up. His age had reached a point where he could be a free moral agent. He could make his own decisions. He could do what he wanted to do with his life. He didn't have to listen to his mother anymore, the precious mother who had pulled him, as it were, from the Nile River and had saved his life and raised him. She's the one who pumped him full of Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. She pumped Moses full of the fact that he was God's chosen. She pumped him full of the things that he was going to do. She made him pray. She made him go to church. No doubt she made him kneel down. No doubt she made him trust in God. She made him pray before food. She took care of him and made him a godly young man. There came a day in his life when he had a decision to make. And when he was old enough to say, I don't want to do it anymore, you know what he did? He said, I'm going to do it the rest of my life. He said, God is too important to me, and I have got too many things in my life that are at stake. I'm going to keep serving God. It doesn't matter who tells me. If they tell me I can't go to church, I'm going to find a church. If they tell me I have to sit in the front of the church, I'm going to sit a little bit closer to the front. If they tell me to pray for 30 minutes, I'm going to pray for an hour. I'm going to give God more than I've ever been expected to give him. That's just what I'm feeling right now from this scripture. The scripture tells us by faith Moses, when he was come to years, he made a decision. He refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. You talk about an opportunity to be the kingpin, number one, top of the heap, big cheese in the whole world. He could have been. He could have been the top guy. History tells us he could have taken King Tut's place. King Tut would have been someone as a subsequent individual to him if he had decided that he wanted to do whatever his own human heart desired. But I want to say thank God for a precious mother. What was Moses' mother's name? Time for a little Sunday school trivia. Ready? Go. What was it? What was Moses' mother's name? Herod. Moses had a mama. Moses' mother raised him. Remember all that whole miracle? Jochebed. That sound familiar? Jochebed. How many of you already looked it up on Google real quick? Give me the answer. Jochebed. You know what? It's not Mother's Day right now, but I want to say thank God for the godly mothers who know how to raise their kids to reach a point where they, when they get old enough, they say, I'm going to keep going to church. They get old enough to say, I just want to, my mama made it look too good. She made it taste too good. She made it feel too good. She helped me to understand that I had a possibility in the world to come. I'm going to tell you, Moses did not yet know fully what God had in store for him, but he had a mama who put a vision in his heart. He had a mama who told him, Moses, you need to keep on serving God. And there came a point in his life when he knew he didn't have to obey his mama anymore. It was his choice. And what was his choice? I'll tell you what his choice was. He decided that he would never indulge as an unleashed young person. Indulgence he never unleashed. He could have. Somebody gave him the checkbook of the kingdom. He could have done whatever he wanted to do with it. But he made a choice. He said, my heart is not mine. I've been raised by a mother who knew how to teach me the priorities of my life. If God is not my highest priority, then nothing else matters. And if God isn't the one I surrender to, then I might as well not surrender to anybody else, and nobody should worry about surrendering to me. I'm not worthy of being in charge of anybody if I can't be under the leadership of somebody. So Moses is basically going forward saying, you know what? I know I could do this, but when I'm old enough and as I'm old enough, thank you, Mother, for what you told me. You put the training wheels on my bike, and now I'm going to take the training wheels off and I'm going to keep on riding. Not that I'm going to fall down and not that I'm going to stop riding my bike. I'm going to keep on. In fact, I'm going to go to bigger and better places and things and do things that you never dreamed, Mama. And it's because you put the training wheels on my bike. Well, I say thank God for a man who showed us that indulgences are there, but they do not have to be engaged in. They do not have to be enjoyed. Indulgence he never unleashed. You see that in the scripture? He refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. All he had to do was say, yeah, Pharaoh, son of Pharaoh's daughter. Pharaoh is my grandpa. Pharaoh is the one, I call him grandpa, and I can do whatever I want. Somehow, The man named Moses was filled with meekness, knowing he could, but he simply didn't. Knowing he could indulge if his appetites were unleashed, but he held back. And he said, that's not what God created me to do. I could do it for sure. And just because I want to, I could do it. But I'm going to say to my heart, be meek, heart. Have a meek heart. I want to be a meek young man. I want to say thank God for young people in the church who are right now engaging in meekness lifestyles, knowing that you could do things that the world would really applaud, and you could become someone, and you could have a place of prominence, and you could probably reach out and really become somebody in this world, but you've chosen to be a man or a woman of God, come what may. He refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Indulgence he never unleashed. What does the next verse say? Verse 25. He chose rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Is sin fun? Come on. Pastor, that's a loaded question. No, it's not. I'm going to unload it right now. The bullet's on the ground. Ready? Is sin fun? We know it is. Sin is pleasurable. There are pleasures of sin, but they are the veil over the evil, the devastation, the destruction, the slime, the grotesque stuff inside that once it's been enjoyed, kind of like you lick the layers off a lollipop on the inside, there's something you never saw, you could never expect or never intend, but there it is. It only lasts for a little while. It only has a season. So you know what? I'm going to tell you, I want to say thank God for an example in Ahab to show us what not to do. But at the same time, I want to say thank God for an example in Moses to show us what to do. You know what Moses did? Moses was a man who made a choice. And he said, I know I could indulge if I wanted to because it's right there at my front door. But you know what I'm going to do instead? I'm never going to let the attraction trap me. Attractions that never trapped Moses. There are attractions that are pulling on people today in this sanctuary. There are people who are watching this broadcast. People are watching this recording. And there are attractions today. All you'd have to do is push pause. All you got to do is just check out for a minute. You could probably write a list of two or three things down right now that are going through your mind. You've hardly been able to pay attention to the preaching or the singing because you've got attractions. Things that are going on in your mind. They're calling your name. They're pulling on you. And you're kind of thinking, as soon as this is over, I can just get myself a free minute. I can just get myself a free time where nobody's watching. If I can just get myself a little extra moment in time where I don't think anybody's going to know, I'm going to do it. I've got an attraction. I've got an attraction that's pulling on me. Can I tell you that you're not the only one in that position? Thank God for an example in the name of Moses who said, you know what, I've got attractions pulling on me and they look good. They I've heard they're good. There are things that I'm hearing about sin that are pleasurable and enjoyable, but you know what, I'm not going to let them trap me. I'm not going to put my foot in that bear trap. There's no way that I'm going to get all caught up in that. So you know what, I'm thankful he's a man who said, do not let the attractions trap you and carry you to a place you never intended to go. Aren't you thankful for the word of God? I say, Lord Jesus, transform my heart. Help me to have a heart like Moses. Help me, Lord, to have a heart that knows there is really something down under the surface of that pleasure that is indeed destructive. It is indeed short term. It is short lived. Somebody lift your hands with me right now and help me pray for God to help us to receive. Help us to receive, Lord. Help us to be receivers, Lord. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Be not as the horse or as the mule, which have no understanding, whose mouth must be held in with bit and bridle, lest they come near to thee. Don't be someone dense. Don't be someone who is obtuse. Don't be someone who cannot see past their nose. Don't be myopic in your thinking. Got to see that there is more to the enemy's attraction than you can possibly begin to understand. So what we've got to do is we've got to get a handhold. Got to get a handle on selfishness is what we've got to do. Because selfishness indeed is what drives desire to become destructive. Charles Finney, preacher of yesteryear, he said, selfishness consists in dethroning reason from the seat of government and enthroning blind desire in opposition to the seat of reason. He said, selfishness is always and by necessity unreasonable. He says it is a denial of that divine attribute that allies human beings to God. It's a denial of that attribute. And it makes us incapable of virtue. Selfishness dethrones reason and sinks humans to the level of a brute. He says it is a contempt for the voice of God within him. I want to say thank you, Lord, for the voice of God within me. Listen, if you have the ability to just close your eyes and call on the Lord, you should be able to hear a voice of reason, a voice of God. Selfishness is keeping people in their pew right now. Selfishness is keeping people from wanting to pray right now. Listen, I want you to know this is an apostolic church. This altar is open. Anytime anybody wants to come, I'm wrapping up. I really am. I'm finished. I just want to wrap up with a couple of words while you're coming. But the bottom line is, if you close your eyes and think about it, I want you to know that there is a voice of God that wants to speak to you, and it can't speak from the inside, from the outside. It speaks from the inside. I know you're hearing voice sound waves that are coming from a PA to your ears, but there's something that has to speak on the inside to your reasoning capability. And today, I want you to understand, it is possible for you to deny and for you to be driven to the level of a brute, but it is possible. And I want to say thank God for everybody who has said, Lord, I'm not going to let his sovereignty be trampled down. I don't want my intelligence to be insulted. Shame on selfishness. It dethrones human reason and would dethrone the divine mind and would place blind lust upon the throne of the universe. That's the danger of desire out of control. Dangerous desires or higher desires. Dangerous desires or higher desires. Let's stand together, everyone. Let me wrap this up with the last verse. Holy Ghost is moving and speaking. Here it is. I want you to hear it. Hebrews 11:26. Oh, this could be you. This could be me. I hope it's everyone in this place. Here is meekness. Meekness decided not to indulge and not to let the attraction do trapping or deception. Instead, he esteemed the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. For had he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. So you know what? Moses became the recipient of a reward that could never be taken away. Some of you who are life group leaders here, if you have a burden and you're hearing the word today, I'd like to invite you forward maybe to receive and to welcome guests as they come. Anybody that's not Holy Ghost filled, I want you to know you can receive the Holy Ghost today. What is receiving the Holy Ghost? Let me tell you, it's so simple. It really is a transplant of the old man, the old way of thinking, the old dead-end concepts of life, and saying, my life is not my own, and I'm ready to start all over. What I've been preaching about today is the essence of repentance. Acts 2:38 says, repent and be baptized. Come on down, life group leaders. If you have a burden and you're going to join us in prayer around this altar, you can be the first wave to help everybody else here today to see the need. Feel a measure of comfort as they come forward. The Holy Ghost is moving in this place. Let's not be so distracted by the attractions, by the thin veiled tinsel and toys of this world. They're so deceptive. Can I tell you, there's something so important here today? It's this: the gospel of Jesus Christ. When you have received the gift of the Holy Ghost, you know what you're doing? You're putting on the throne of your life. You're putting Almighty God's ability to guide your desire. The Bible says that when they repented of their sins and were baptized in Jesus' name, they spake with tongues as the Spirit gave the utterance. They were baptized and they received the Holy Ghost. What does it mean to receive the Holy Ghost? It simply means to have inside, inside, the ability to say, I am not my own. And I would do that if it weren't for the Holy Ghost. But I have the Holy Ghost in me, and the Holy Ghost comes alongside and guides my process of thinking, guides the things that attract me. Normally, those things might be pulling me, but they're going to change. They're not going to pull me in the direction of destruction anymore. I'm going to be like Moses. Moses is our example today. And I'm going to tell you here today that Moses said, I don't want a reward like Ahab. A reward that I'll never enjoy. Quite the opposite. Moses opted for a reward that could never be stolen. Let's pray. It's prayer time, church. It's prayer time. We've got some loving life group leaders in this altar right now, ready to receive, ready to meet you and greet you and lead you in prayer. I get everybody here to sanctuary to begin to think about your heart. I like even those who've been filled with the Holy Ghost before, but your walk with God is somewhat under fire today. And you know, the devil would like to topple you. He would like to push you. He would like to destroy you, but you're going to take a stand today. You're going to be stronger than the enemy. Anybody feel that today? I invite you to this altar. Join right in with those who are coming to pray. Hallelujah, in Jesus' name. This is God's plan and God's will. Let's see how well we're doing today with divine desire. Are we going to surrender to higher desire, or is this all about illegitimate desire that pulls us into a place we never intended to go? Possessions we never intended, we'll never get to enjoy. Appreciate those who are already coming. Altar still open. I believe the Holy Ghost is here today, ready to receive. Come on up and find a place to pray. Let's just surrender our desires to the Lord right now. I'm believing the Lord's about to give some hearts the desires that are needed and transform our everlasting life. Transform us from this moment forward, giving us a brand new outlook. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, somebody. I'm excited about the reward. The reward that can never be taken away. All this world has is temporary treasure, temporary pleasure. I'm here today offering to you pleasure forevermore in His presence. That's right, in the presence of Jehovah, there is pleasure forevermore. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And the Lord bless this word to your heart as I turn it back over to the pastors.